Hello and welcome to my talk about a current research project for me. That's MicroSTU or Transactional Image Update. My name is Thorsten Kuckuck. I think most of you know me already. I'm nearly at every OpenSUSE conference speaking and talking a little bit about what my team is doing. So I'm Thorsten Kuckuck, distinguished engineer at SUSE, senior architect, and most important, also the team lead of the future technology team, which means we are looking at new technologies, play with them, and try to create proof of concept prototypes, which then could be included in our commercial or OpenSUSE projects. I'm since over 20 years with SUSE, and I'm now since over 25 years an open source developer, started with glibc and the Linux NIST implementations a long, long time ago. At first, to make sure that everybody understands the same if I speak about an image, because if you hear it from the previous talks, everybody is using the definition of image in a different way. For this talk, an image is something like a file which you can write into a disk partition, a butterfs subvolume, or loopback mount, and then you have always a verifiable, reproducible state which is identical on every machine where you install that. So we are not speaking here about a full disk image which includes a partition or a bootloader or anything else you need, so which you dump to a raw disk, boot it, and everything is then there. So what's the problem? No. Somehow the slides are mixed up. Okay, I will fix later. So, why do we look at image-based updates? There is a customer demand for it. Very often, if I'm at conferences, especially in the embedded area, people always say image-based solutions with AB partition schemes or something similar is the only way what is acceptable for this. And if you then ask them why not use something package-based, there are valid reasons and a lot of myths around it. So valid reasons, use cases for me are certifications, especially safety certifications. Only think about cars, trains, medical devices and similar things. Well, it is really critical that it works as designed in all cases. But also, if you think about consumer devices or IoT hardware, so where you have a huge amount of really identical hardware and the users of it are not technically skilled and where you only have a few updates, so that is also good use cases for image-based installations and updates. If you have more valid use cases, please send them to me via email or tell me afterwards, because I'm really looking for this research project for something. But I also hear a lot of myths on in this discussions, like that it saves QA, that if you update the system, all malware is wiped out because you write one partition new. So about saves QA, up to today, nobody was really convincing me that he really saves QA for him, quite the opposite. I was more under the impression that people didn't really understand how real good testing is working. An update wipes out malware is also wrong, because what I update is one partition, which is read-only, which is protected by DMVerity or similar approaches. So there is no malware writing into this part. The malware will install itself on a write-able part of the disk, and this is not overwritten with an update. So as long as you don't have a really stateless system where you cannot write on disk, there is always a way for malware to survive an update or a reboot. So, for example, for CoreOS, I had these discussions very often, and I wrote a small script installing a malware, and the admin was not able to remove it by updating the system only as a forward proof of concept. Also people always telling me, nothing can break if you do image-based update. Of course, if I write an image to a disk and the disk is broken, then the image is afterwards broken too. So the problems are the same. The low-level problems, only the high-level problems may look different for you. And often I hear that they are as flexible with image-based updates as they would be with package-based updates. So I spoke a lot of with three micro customers and micro S customers in the last year, and I can only tell we have a huge amount of three micro customers who are new customers because they are coming from the image-based world and they're saying images are everything else but not flexible at all. So at the last Hack Week, I thought, okay, create a simple approach. We have transactional update, which is updating RPMs, make a few modifications to it, and then update images instead of RPMs. That's why I called it transactional image update. But here I was a little bit too naive and didn't have enough experience with it, because transactional update includes ETC in the snapshot, but ETC is everything else but not static. And especially it's not identical on different hardware. One of the first things is ETC S-stub, because if you have different hardware, most likely the paths to your partitions are different. And in this moment, this all breaks, falls together, and I didn't manage to really get it working, so I have to look at something new here. So I thought to remember in the past I hacked some of my consumer devices I have, and what I learned from this, I remembered so. I had a digital model railway control unit, the Märklin Central Station 2. I don't know if anybody knows it here. I had a vacuum robot and my SAT receiver and recorder. They all have in common that they are using Linux. Also, they are using an image-based approach. But I also found out they are not really flexible with this images-based. Especially for the first two, they are really very inflexible with updating the image. And fixing critical bugs takes sometimes over a year. So some user of the Märklin Central Station 2 know what I'm speaking about normally, about the software crashing if you read a digital decoder from your locomotives and similar things. So what did I did to get access to these machines? For the first two, I downloaded the update, the next update, the image, analyzed it. I modified the image like I wanted. I deployed the image as update, and it works. I had root access to the device via SSH. So besides all the bugs, the first mistakes companies are doing is there is no secure supply chain, because any attacker could have applied an update on these machines, and not only me who wanted to have root access. Also, the image-based update is not a partition A/B scheme. It's really, I have one big partition with the system. I have one small image for the update system. So what they do is, because flash memory is expensive, they boot a small image which updates the big image. And if that fails, then you have nearly lost. And I had to send in my central station, I think, 2 times because they released broken updates, which lead to unusable, no longer recoverable system. The SAT receiver is doing hybrid thing. They offer image-based updates, but on the other side, they need packages because the plugins are provided as package you install in the image. So normally the people only update the packages, and updating the image is really complicated. But I learned a lot from this. from my own experience with these devices, with the usage of the devices, also from the feedback and discussions with other users of them. And the most important one is really the core supply chain. Independent if you get the update over the air, so via network or offline by USB stick, always ever check that the update is really what the producer of the device is releasing, because like I could modify the update and apply it, anybody else could with a DNS proof attack, whatever, provide a broken in the core update or one with malware, and you install it automatically, and then your device is hacked and under control by people you clearly don't want on your device. Also, a real rollback, which includes configuration files, are important, together with a full factory reset. And a full factory reset would really delete all new files and not just overwrite some index files and keep the old ones. So one reason for the vacuum robot hack was that it was one of the very first models who tried to draw a map of your flat. But if you move furniture around, if you closed a door to a room, then it got completely confused and you have to delete the old maps so that he can work again. But the developers never imagined that that there would be a need to remove the old maps, so it was not possible at all. Even if you did a factory reset of the device, all the old maps were still there, so you need to hack the firmware to be able to delete the old maps that the robot was functional again. So now I go back to the... So why do I look at image-based updates now is... No, wrong. That was the slide I was looking for. So what's the problem? The most solutions I found here and have in-house are very hardware, firmware, or use case specific. So it's not a general usage you could use for different things. OpenSUSE itself does not have any production-ready generic solution today. And important is that people should feel at home if they know OpenSUSE, if they use an image-based approach. Like MicroS, besides the read-only root file system, doesn't look from the usage of the commands. If you use it at container host, for example, doesn't look much different than a tumbleweed using as container host. And it should be usable beside container or the Kubernetes world. Only think about trains, buses, medical devices. So this is all something which we never really looked at or invested in the past, but where I often get asked for if we don't have a solution there. No. So there are similar projects. So some weeks ago, Leonard Pöttering as a systemd maintainer released a really good blog how a really secure image-based update system, in his opinion, could look like. And he only used systemd more or less for it. So every part of it is systemd. It's similar as ideas I had with my team, but he is much better in writing it together in a nice long blog than I'm. So it's really worth to read for that reason, and especially about some important thoughts about it. Like, if you do this, make sure that all components are somehow usable for a traditional distribution too. Don't create something completely independent, because it's also important that, as I said already, it looks like to a user like a normal distribution, because only then you get the acceptance of the people who are using already the normal distributions. If they have to learn everything from scratch new, then most likely they will never look at what you create there. So the two biggest problems I see on his blog is, one, it's too systemd-centric, so he's limiting himself too much to what he implemented for parts. There are better solutions or more flexible solutions, so it's not really flexible in some parts. And what that completely missed is update of configuration files because they are living outside of the image. Another nice project is SWUpdate. It looks like it's a standard in the industry, in the embedded area, together with Yocto. So if you want to use this, you will find nearly only descriptions and code how to use it together with Yocto, but not standalone with another project. The documentation is really worth reading it, for especially if it's about the requirements of such consumer and device systems, edge devices, embedded systems, with over-the-air updates. Because, and this is something I learned too, you want to transfer only the real changes, not the whole big image on the one side. On the other side, if you have to open a lot of connections to the web server to download all blocks in a single way, then you would need hours until the system is updated. So if you want to understand more the problems of image-based updates, that is really worth to read. Now coming to MicroSTO, this image-based installation and update, my research project. I started it in the last second, as I said, to learn what is possible and required if you do image-based updates and to find out what we need to change in our code base. And the features I was thinking about is having one command line interface, small program, which can be act as installer to set up the disk and the bootloader, but also to be able to update later the image. Only /user is image-based, so it's one image, you can protect whatever you want or think about. It's stateful, and rollback includes etc. That were so the main requirements for me. And how it works, what I have today as proof of concept is we have a Python script which reads a YAML config and then uses libstorageng as backend to partition your disk. So in the YAML config, you describe your disk layout, what should be partitions, what should be butterfs subvolumes, and then the outcome is the same as if you would use a YAS disk partitioner. And it's really great, it's really fast, and it's really flexible. You have all the advantages of using YAST in the end for partitioning the disk, but you don't have the big overhead of YAST, which you don't need for an image-based deployment. And I deploy only /user, not even user local, so really only /user. And I have a separate etc, which contains the host-specific config files. I can set up the bootloader. I use ignition and combustion for the first boot to personalize the system. And if there is no config for these tools, then first boot will start and you can enter your root password with that. And after every installation or update, systemd-sys users and systemd-temp files will populate etc with all updates from the system. So the disk layout is pretty simple. I have in the end three partitions. The root partitions, which is read-write, contains etc and the boot directory and the mount points for everything else. Then I have /user, which is read-only and will be updated as image. This can be a butterfs snapshot. So then you have user.snapshots 1, 2, as you know it from Snapper, for micro as with transaction updates or tumbleweed. And I also have a mode where it works with two partitions, A, B, or even more. And as third partition, I have the var partition, which is read-write for all the stateful data, system data of your workload. And it can only be updated by systemd services. I mentioned already a little bit, I have two operation modes. One is I try to use butterfs subvolumes for the images. This has a nice advantage that you really store, like with transactional update, only the fan with to the old snapshot on disk. So it's really very space efficient. And it's much more flexible than with fixed size partitions, because if I have a big partition and the snap images get bigger and bigger, I don't run into the situation that the partitions on disk are too small and I have to reinstall everything. But I can limit the number of snapshots, win more free space with it, and in this case, I can create bigger images than original I had original in mind. I have a working proof of concept for it. And the biggest challenge here is I cannot have one snapshot like with Tumbleweed, MicroS, Slash, or similar things, because I have to separate the root file system with etc and the user. So I have two file systems, but I have S file systems, and two have snapshots, and I needed to find a way to keep them in sync. And the best solution I found here is the root file system contains etc fstab, and etc fstab contains the reference what is to be mounted for as user file system. So I modify etc fstab every time and write the new snapshot on user on it. So independent of which root snapshot I boot, I always get the correct user snapshot mounted. This is working fine as long as not somebody thinks he knows it better than the system and start up with snapper deleting random snapshots, because for the cleanup you may need to make sure that you only delete the user partitions which are referenced in the deleted or no longer used by the root partition, so by etc fstab referenced. So you need to do some housekeeping there. It's doable. It's still on my to-do list to implement that. So the cleanup code is missing, but it's doable. And one of the other big problems is etc. If I create a snapshot, then it's only activated after the next reboot. So I have a time in which the admin could make changes which are not in the new snapshot or the new system. That's the same problem as we had with transactional update. With transactional update, Ignaz found the solution with stacking overlay FS. I tried to find a better solution because using overlay FS will prevent us from using some security technology which does not work with overlay FS. But in the end, it looks like I have to take the same implementation for etc as we use for transactional update today. The second operation mode, and this is what customers are really interested in, they don't understand the snapshot and subvolume technology from ButterFS, so they want a clear separation in user A, user B, maybe user C or D in partitions, even if it limits them more, because this is what they know, what they understand. So I tried to implement something similar, but it's not, I don't have a working proof of concept yet here, because the technologies I tried first don't work very well. I can modify etc fstab like with the subvolumes, but that's not really looking nice, create other problems. There's a mount user kernel command line option from systemd. That would be really great, but it's not yet supported by ignition and combustion. So I need to implement or enhance at first the scripts from ignition and combustion for this. I don't have a real good solution yet how to keep the snapshot and partitions in sync, because I have a fixed number of partitions, but a more or less unlimited number of snapshots I can create. ETC is the same problem as with ButterFS, and yes. So ButScience, yesterday evening we have a SW update, creating images, updating them, working. That is maybe what we look next. But the biggest problem I have here is efficient image transfer. So the updates should be distributed over the air in a secure way, so HTTPS, FTP, and it should be space efficient. so that you can download only what has changed and you don't need to download a 2 or 3 gigabyte image, but only the few kilobyte you need which have really changed. Additionally, if you look at the mirror infrastructure of OpenSUSE, this mostly IR-sync a directory and provides this via HTTPS. So it all has to work with a plain web server without additional services running on this mirror. And on the other side, you want to have a complete image, e.g. USB stick. That is the easiest part. Secure supply chain, I said already. Verification, every step needs to be verified. And really important is the image the customer points to is really an image for this system? Is it compatible with it? Is the current installed system new enough to be able to update to the new image? And most important, is it for the same architecture or not? So there are also a lot of other things normally RPM and Zipper would do for you. We now need to re-implement for images. The distributions who are going in this direction are, for example, CoreOS. They download blocks from the X3 file system, reassemble it locally, and write it to disk. Fedora CoreOS with OS3 is using files. Ubuntu Core is using SCROFFS images and mounting them. And then I stumbled about a project called Rauk, which has many interesting ideas, and they're using CA-Sync. And when I read the features of CA-Sync, it sounded like the ideal tool for it. It's a combination of the AirSync algorithm and content addressable storage. So the content addressable is a CA in the sync. It claims to provide an efficient way to store and retrieve multiple related versions of a large file system or a directory trees. It has ButterFS support, especially reflinks, and it could verify the written image. But there is always a big discrepancy between marketing on the one side and the reality on the other side. Most of the features are not implemented or are broken. Especially the ButterFS support is pretty broken. So I had to create several images to download because independent if you use subvolumes or directories or partitions, you need to create a different image. So it's a poor mess and the upstream project is dead. If you look at the issues, you will find a lot of people having similar problems than I had and there's no reaction anymore. So to use the async, I had to need implement a lot of workaround and hacks, which made the system really ugly and not maintainable and not really robust. The result was it's not reproducible, not verifiable, and it's not space efficient because with all the workarounds about the broken ButterFS implementations, you need more space than really needed. So what were the options? We invest into this tool. I myself don't have another the time nor the deep knowledge you would need to do that. Or somebody comes up with a good alternative idea. Somebody from my team pointed me to de-easing, which claims to be a drop-in replacement for CA-sync. But in the end, it's an implementation which is able to read CA-sync created archives, but everything else is not compatible at all. And it cannot sync an archive with the local disk, but it can only untar the archive on the local disk. So you need to delete everything before and then install the image. So all ButterFS functionality features are void. But it did allow me to remove ugly hacks like bind mounts and so on I needed for CA-sync. So this is something, if somebody really knows a good tool for this, please send me the link or the name. Then I would maybe look for the ButterFS subvolume proof of concept, but currently that part is dead in my opinion. So how does TU Work. It's, as I said, a command line tool which can create or build the images. For this, we create take a tar archive of the new snapshot. I build this in the build service with Kiwi, and then as Kiwi postdoc, I call TU build and create the image. So it contains etc, but not as left etc, but as user share factory etc. This is because of this dmd temp file, so I can copy the most important part, which are still in etc, but should not be there, in my opinion. So it will contain user, not user local, and everything else, var and so on, gets removed. It's not part of the image because the image is only slash user. So then I build the async or the async archives, create a squash image from it with a manifest. The manifest explains what is inside of this image for which architecture, what is the minimal version to be installed so that I can do an update. The whole thing is verified with DM Verity. What's missing is a signature for the DM Verity hef that you know it's really correct. So it's on the to-do list, but I'm not sure if I will need it because I have meanwhile another idea. So the installation is you point TU install to the device you want to install on. If you don't specify anything else, then it will download the default image and install it. But you can also point it or give it a path to a local or remote archive with the image. It downloads the image, it verifies it. It partitions the disk with Snip Storage NG based on the YAML config file for this installation method, extract user. It populates a minimal etc, which means etc fstab, everything needed for the bootloader. And etc pass with D initial one. It set up the bootloader, and then you can already boot the first time the system. If you look at the disk before you boot, it's really minimal we write to it. There's nearly nothing on the root file system. That's all done by ignition, combustion, juice first boot, systemd first boot, systemd users, systemd temp files. So all the standard tools people know already, we ship anyways, we support anyways, are setting up the part outside of the image. The workflow for updating with ButterFS is similar. We download the image, we verify it, make sure it's compatible with the current installed system, create a new snapshot of the root file system and of user, adjust etc fstab inside of the snapshot of the root file system, update user, update the kernel in boot and the bootloader boot. And now systemd, this user systemd temp files and everything else will continue to run again and update the system outside of the image. The workflow with update with partitions is similar, except that we don't write into a ButterFS subvolume, we write into a partition. Now for package trust, the most important part, if you think about building an image, then it's quite different to installing an RPM on the final host. So if you install a package on your system and there are pre or post install scripts, they see what is configured, they see your host and can act accordingly. If you run the same scripts when you build an image which should be deployed on many different machines, then they see the machine on which we build the image, not the machine on which it should run. They don't see etc, they don't see var, so they don't see anything outside user. And that is also important here is we need a strict separation of the config files from etc with stateful data from var and the OS of user. And you cannot assume in a pre-pro install RPM fast that you can access etc, that you see other packages and so on. So some more requirements is two technologies I identified already as completely incompatible. One is SE Linux. So I know Fedora, Aurel, Atomic have some hex for it by copying data around from user to the right directories in etc and var. In my opinion, it would be much better to enhance SE Linux tools so that you can separate them, and under user, you have the default shipped by the distribution, and in var, you only have the changes made by an admin, which also would make it much easier to update a policy without getting conflicts in the var part. Update alternatives uses etc and var. You have both, you don't have any of them with the image. Never use update alternatives for an image-based system. In this case, we have a solution with alt, which is much better in this regard and works with an image-based approach because it was designed also with transaction update in mind. Avoid pre-post installation update scripts because they will not work anyways correct. So you don't have, as I said, access to anything outside of the user image. And instead, everything has to be done via systemd at the first boot of this image, which also means you have to update config files outside of user in the first thing. And files should be owned by root in the image, because if you introduce your own users, the user database is in etc. So if you deploy the image and you have your own users, then you write a static UID, you use a static UID for these files when you build the image, but there's no guarantee that this static UID you used in the image will match later with etc passwd of the system. So avoid files owned by anything else than by root in this. Okay, what's next? So what are my, so currently I have a proof of concept which is partly working with Butterfly subvolumes, not working with user IB partitions. So I will now concentrate on the IB partition use case and will use SWupdate for it. It looks like that is really the best choice. But I, of course, modify it, find out how to use it without Yocto, but with our build service and on our products. Then I need to invest more into the bootloader setup. We have a lot of code for rollbacks if you use snapshots, but we have no code in grub for selecting partitions from which to boot and continuing cleaning up etc so that I can remove all the hacks there. So if you want to help, if you have use cases, if you have ideas for other tools which could solve parts of the problems better, please tell me, send me a link to it. So especially I need better ideas for etc handling. So how to make sure that from the time I create the new update until the reboot, I don't lose the changes and admin mates is during time. How could a good bootloader menu look like to select the partitions A, B, C for a rollback or use the default one? Which is the default one? SE Linux, I really need, I want to have SE Linux working with this image-based approach. Everything else doesn't make any sense in my opinion. So if there are SE Linux experts or people knowing how Red Hat or Fedora solved that with this image-based, I'm always happy to hear or get help there. We need additional security measurements and the most important part, documentation. I'm always behind because implementing some lines of code, trying it out is much faster than writing the documentation and document what you did so that every end user and developer understands it. There's a GitHub project in my home. So github.com thkukuktiu. There's in my home project, homekukuktiu on OBS, all the code you need. Also, there are also installer images and update archives. So you can use that already, play with it, but I would really not use it in production because currently I don't guarantee that you can update and that not a fresh installation is required. And with I'm on time finished, so officially we have only 5 seconds for questions. So I think the best is if there are quick one now, but else ask me outside so that we don't disturb the next talks, or send me an email or speak later with me. So are there any quick questions? I don't see anything here. Okay, then I want to thank you for listening to this, and I hope I get some, or I could create some interest and get some help for this. Thank you.